A surprise suggestion from the president's press secretary.
Would the president encourage the DOJ to prosecute Comey?
That's not the president's role. That's the job of the Department of Justice and something they should certainly look at.
Why Sarah Sanders says the DOJ should weigh prosecuting the former FBI director. Next.
The White House is suggesting the Justice Department take a look at prosecuting former FBI Director James Comey. Administration officials claim he is a leaker who lied to Congress. The president's press secretary, Sarah Sanders, making a case for criminal charges.
Comey, by his own self-admission, leaked privileged government information weeks before President Trump fired him. His actions were improper and likely could have been illegal.
Would the president encourage the DOJ to prosecute Comey?
That's not the president's role. That's the job of the Department of Justice and something they should certainly look at.
Is that something you'd like to see?
I'm not sure about that specifically, but I think if there's ever a moment where we feel someone's broken the law, particularly if they're the head of the FBI, I think that's something that certainly should be looked at.
Wow. All right, let's go live to Washington, bring in Zach Wolf. He's the digital director of CNN Politics. Good morning, Zach.
Morning, Zach.
Good morning.
All right, how unusual is that suggestion from the White House podium? And is there any law that, as we know it, Comey broke?
Well, I would say it's pretty unusual, but it's no more unusual than firing the FBI director, you know, in the face of Russian meddling questions. So we're still in uncharted territory here. I don't think we're going to find our way back into normalcy for quite a while. I don't think that there is a law I've seen that Comey, that I know about, that Comey broke. I haven't seen many people say that. He did share some information, you know, with a law school professor, but it's not exactly clear to me if that was just him talking with the president or if it was classified. I'm sure if they are able to prosecute him in Donald Trump's Justice Department, they will look at a way to do it. On the other hand, he's a paragon of the justice community. These are people who would investigate him who probably have a lot of respect for him. So yeah. I'm not holding my breath for that one.
Yeah, we do know that memo was not classified, that information he shared with his professor, maybe privileged, but not classified.
Can we talk a little bit about what's happening on the other side of the aisle for a moment? Because there's a lot of talk about this Bernie Sanders movement for single payer, Medicare for all, and this idea that this could be the new, as one of the op-eds in a paper to this morning said, this could become the repeal and replace for the Democrats, this Medicare for all mantra. What do you make of what's happening there?
It's really, really incredible. It has essentially become a litmus test for all of these Democrats who are sort of eyeing the Democratic nomination in 2020. People like Kamala Harris, people like Kirsten Gillibrand, people who, a couple of years ago, Hillary Clinton said it was impossible to do this. It's not possible. She's been she's now selling this book saying the ideas of Bernie Sanders were too pie in the sky. They couldn't be achieved. And now you have all the people who want to succeed her as the top Democrat, essentially joining on to something that Democrats for so long, Barack Obama, when they passed, you know, they tried to have a public option with Obamacare. Didn't work. And now you have basically the entire field of Democrats to choose from signing on to this idea.
But not leadership. Chuck and Nancy have not yet signed on to this bill. Right. They're making deals with President Trump. So as much as the suggestion is that Republicans are fractured, are Democrats completely in the weed here? And is there potential peril in those people signing aboard to this single payer bill?
Well, I mean, there's peril in that they're making a promise that they likely, in today's political climate at least, can't deliver on. There's not much peril because this thing is never going to get a vote. It's never going to get to the House floor. It's never going to get to the Senate floor until Democrats take charge of those bodies. And they could do that in 2018. The Senate seems like kind of a stretch, but there's only political peril if they end up having to put their money where their mouth is, and they don't right now.
Front page of all the papers this morning, paychecks hit high for middle class. You know, President Trump really rode to the White House on the coattails of this idea that the middle class was just getting screwed, right? And you see median income up 3%, 59,000 median family income, more opportunities for people in the labor market, record job openings. Do you think money really is at the core of what was driving the Trump base, or was it culture?
Wow, that's a great question. Do I have to choose? I think it was
okay,
probably a little bit of both. And I think that money might be, you know, have something to do with culture as well. If you look at he wrote to the idea that it was this middle class getting screwed, but the people he relied on, I think, as his political base are these uneducated white voters, states who, you know, might have already been left behind, mm-hmm. I think, by the middle class. So there's a distinction there. That's important.
A good point.
And of course, the economic story there is the tax cuts, tax reform. Which is it going to be? Will there be bipartisan work on that? We'll discuss that with you in about 30 minutes. President Trump met with three Democratic senators last night, members of the House today, see if they can build a coalition. We'll talk about it in just a bit. Those are the Democrat and Republican senators they met with last night. Again, we'll talk about that within about 30 minutes. So a quick programming note, Hillary Clinton, she'll speak tonight on CNN with Anderson Cooper. If you haven't heard, she's written a book. It's called What Happened. That's tonight, 8 Eastern time. Hillary and Anderson here on CNN.
All right. In the wake of Equifax's huge security fail, lawmakers want to investigate three executives for insider trading. 36 U.S. senators seek a federal probe into $2 million in Equifax shares sold after the internal discovery of that hack back in July. Equifax only made the news of the hack public last week. Equifax's breach exposed the personal data of 143 million of you, and its response has been widely condemned. For example, at first, Equifax only offered free credit monitoring if victims waived your right to sue. Couldn't join a class action, sign up here. It later backtracked due to let's call it prompting by the New York Attorney General. Massachusetts state attorney plans to sue Equifax, and the hack even concerns the U.S. Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin.
Americans shouldn't expect these things to happen, and the current situation is obviously quite unfortunate.
It's unfortunate and it's unfair, and it does happen too often here. Mnuchin added that the safety of U.S. financial data is his top priority. Stay tuned to see if there are new regulations on the financial industry because of this? Doubtful. Equifax CEO Richard Smith accepts all of this criticism, and there's plenty of it. He wrote an op-ed that the company vows to strengthen against cyber crime.
All right, here's the deal. In the commercial break, I checked out how long it takes to find out if you've been compromised. It takes like 2 minutes.
Okay.
I had not been. A person right next to me had. Check it out. Do it. Also, stay tuned, because the Cleveland Indians attempting to rewrite baseball history last night. Coy Wire has history in this morning's Bleacher Report. Next. All right, this amazing late season run continues for the Cleveland Indians. The Tribe, 20 straight wins.
Coy Wire has more in this morning's Bleacher Report. Hi, Coy.
Top of the morning to you, Christine and Dave. Cleveland lost a heartbreaking World Series to the Cubs last season, but now they are
volunteering in those shelters. Hats off to all of them.
Indeed.
Thanks. Nice to see you,
thanks, Coy. Indians, noon Eastern time, going for 21.
All right. From the Florida Keys to the Virgin Islands and beyond, people are looking at homes, businesses, livelihoods in ruins. Emergency help just starting to get to some towns. This is years of recovery we're facing here, everybody. We have reporters stationed in the areas hardest hit by Irma. Years of rebuilding ahead in the Florida Keys. 90% of homes either damaged or destroyed. More of the same in the Virgin Islands, where the power is out, supplies are running low. We have reporters in the Keys, Tampa, U.S. Virgin Islands, and St. Martin. Welcome back to Early Start this morning. I'm Christine Romans.
I'm Dave Briggs, 31 minutes past the hour. We'll also have some surprising comments from the president's spokesperson about prosecuting James Comey, but up first, the Florida Keys in ruins and starting down the long road to recovery. Authorities and a handful of residents finally reaching some of the areas hardest hit by Hurricane Irma. 25% of the homes on this chain of islands destroyed, another 65% suffering major damage, according to initial FEMA estimates.
All right, in Monroe County, where the Keys are located, there are some signs of progress. We've got about 80% of the roads in the Keys are now cleared. And according to the Florida Department of Transportation, US 1 and all of those 42 bridges linking the Florida Keys inspected and are now safe for travel.
Key West International Airport and Florida Keys Marathon International have opened to handle emergency response flights. They remain closed, though, until further notice for commercial flights. A dusk to dawn curfew also remains in place until further notice.
About 5 million customers throughout the Southeast still without power this morning. That's 5 million customers. That means an awful lot of people. The majority of those customers are in Florida. Nearly two dozen counties remain at least half in the dark. And even in populated areas where power is coming back, 1.5 million customers remain without power.
30,000 out-of-state utility workers trying to help get the lights back on. Full restoration, though, could take weeks for some. President Trump will head to the Fort Myers area of Florida tomorrow as the death toll from Irma has climbed, now reaching 55, 24 of those fatalities in the U.S., Puerto Rico, and the U.S. Virgin Islands. We'll have more from that hard-hit Caribbean area in just a few moments.
The lower Keys remain closed to everyone at this hour, but some residents of the upper Keys are being allowed back into their homes. It doesn't mean, of course, life is returning to normal, anything but everyone along the island chain facing big challenges in the days and weeks ahead. CNN's Brian Todd has more from the hard-hit region.
Christine and Dave, we're in Lower Matacumbe Key, just south of Isla Morada, probably about a third of the way south from Key Largo to Key West. Behind me, you would think this is a single-level family home that got gutted by Hurricane Irma. Well, you'd be wrong if you thought that. This is a three-story condominium complex with 12 units in it that got crunched down to one level. Right behind me is the third floor. Below it, crunched into the ground and into the water, is the second floor and the garage. 12 units in here. We talked to one of the owners. His name is Tom Ross, 73 years old. He's had a unit in here for 18 years. He believes that everybody who lives here evacuated. Thankfully, they did, because they probably wouldn't have survived this. And he says he actually wants to rebuild. He thinks that if they do come here and rebuild it, they'll build it to a better code. This was built in the 1970s where the codes weren't as strong, and he thinks he can get it rebuilt to a better code and survive these strong hurricanes. A lot of frustration on the part of Keys residents as they're coming back into their homes, or trying to. We've seen a steady stream of cars, steady streams of military, police, utility vehicles, all trying to get past checkpoints. Well, at certain points south of us, near Marathon Key and other keys, they're not letting even residents pass the checkpoints because they say it's too dangerous to go in there. Sheriff's deputies tell us if they go in there and something happens to them, they're not going to be able to call out. There are no comms here still. There's no cell phone, there's no landline, there's no water, there's no power. So a lot of frustration on the part of residents down here that that's going on, but the sheriff's deputies and others are saying, look, we've got to do this for your safety. You've got to try to be patient. We don't know when communications and power are going to be back up. I mean, this place is a disaster area. It looks like a war zone throughout this 115-mile stretch of the Florida Keys. Christine and Dave.
All right, Brian Todd there for us in the Keys. Thanks. One of the most critical needs in Florida right now is gasoline. Deliveries are beginning to reach Central Florida, but there are serious challenges getting gas where it's needed most. CNN's Ryan Young has more from Tampa.
Christine and Dave, as the heats up here in Florida, people are looking for a few things. Not only gas, but they're also looking for fast food. In fact, we saw long lines as businesses started to reopen. But that critical need of gas is something that people are still searching for. We spent the day with the Coast Guard as they opened the shipping channels here in Tampa Bay. And that is so important because of all the gas that this port provides to the entire Central Florida area. In fact, if you look behind me, you can see some of those large tankers back there. Those are the first three of seven more that are going to be coming in. So that's going to be 10 total that will be bringing gas to this area. And when you think about this, not only does it provide gas for Central Florida, but for both airports, the Tampa Bay Airport and the Orlando International Airport. Now gas will be flowing back into this area. But there's a kind of a combination that's going on here. You got to think about this. There was an unprecedented run on gas, and that happened as people tried to fill up in preparation of the hurricane. And then the idea that electricity was lost in so many different places. You need that electricity to be able to pump the gas. Those combinations sort of ended up creating an effect here that has a lot of places without gas. And when someone finds out there's a gas station with gas, that run starts all over again. Officials are hoping by the end of the week, the gas will be flowing back through the lines the way we're all accustomed to. Dave and Christine.
All right, Ryan, thank you for that. Hurricane Irma blamed for 31 deaths in the Caribbean. one of the hardest hit areas, St. Martin, the island of St. Martin. A CNN team has reached this Dutch-controlled territory. It is cloaked by an eerie darkness. CNN anchor Cyril Vanier filed this report.
I just want to show you the first impression you get when you get to St. Martin. We're on the Dutch side right now, and when the sun sets, this is it. There's no light. There's so little power on the island right now. So all along down that street, there's an insurance, there's a pizzeria, there's a furniture store and many other stores. Only two of them still have a light that's running. We're actually very fortunate because the biggest newspaper on the island, the Daily Herald, has agreed to let us sleep here. They've got power. They're one of the rare people. For them, the power is working. So the power company is actually going house to house, one by one. They've got to make sure there are no live wires before they can turn it on. We're very fortunate. But let me show you a couple things that are absolutely necessary right now in St. Martin. This is a generator. The few lights that are on in the island, either they're one of the fortunate ones that have the power turned back on, or they have a generator. If they have a generator, then they need some of this. They need the gasoline, but the gas stations, they're all closed. And that buys you, in this building, about 2 hours of power. Let me show you this way. So these are the guys who are have allowed us to stay here, and that's the only reason we can even put this broadcast out there. One of the few things, Tom, I know you're camera shy, I know you didn't want to talk about this, but when you talk to people, this is what happens. Why are you sleeping here?
The roof of my house is gone.
You can't sleep in your house anymore?
Once it gets a little bit better fixed, I will be, yeah, but that's going to be a while.
All right, so for the moment, Tom is one of the many people who's homeless, we can put it that way, and who's sleeping here with his wife. He's part of the sports section at the paper. Let me show you this. This is the lifeline. I was telling you about the gasoline. We consider that this is about 2 hours of power. And with everything that's been filled up, we have maybe 2 days of power. Once that goes out, not much we can do. And this is the printing press. They can't print anymore because this requires water. There's no water. It's essentially what the Dutch Marines are giving you in terms of water. This is the last newspaper they printed on Tuesday. It was the day before the hurricane hit. And this is the headline. Businesses must close at noon, curfew 8 p.m. Now, with all this, there's one glimmer of hope, which is we've learned now that tomorrow, two things are gonna reopen that are key to a normal functioning life here in St. Martin. And that is supermarkets. A couple of supermarkets have said that they're reopening on Wednesday. That's going to bring a great relief if they do open to the population of St. Martin, and gas stations as well. A couple of them have warned that they would reopen. There will be security to ensure that it's done in an orderly fashion. It is the very, very beginning of life restarting in St. Martin.
Cyril Vanier reporting there. He's, of course, from the Caribbean. He grew up in the Caribbean. You know, it's so interesting to me that these islands, you know, these are American citizens who live in many of these islands, St. John, yeah, and St. Thomas, and the U.S. Virgin Islands, of course. These aren't just vacationers we're talking about. We're talking about people who make their livelihoods there. And I'm really worried about, you know, restaurant workers and people who work paycheck to paycheck who are waiting for tourism to come back before they're going to have money to be able to go to that supermarket. Yeah. So
we're really just learning the damage in a lot of these islands as well. All right, ahead, Medicare for all. Is this a good idea for Democrats? A number of high-profile 2020 candidates signing on to Bernie Sanders' single-payer plan. Could it come back to haunt them? We'll discuss. All right, Senator Bernie Sanders unveiling his Medicare for All bill later today, and more than a dozen other senators signing on. Could the Sanders plan become the Democrats' version of repeal and replace? Let's ask Zach Wolf, digital director of CNN Politics Live in Washington this morning.
Zach.
Good morning, Zach. It's not just Democrat senators. It's those who look like they're positioning themselves for a 2020 run. Some very high-profile senators like these few, Kamala Harris, Elizabeth Warren, Kirsten Gillibrand, and Cory Booker, if you want four who were really talked about as 2020 candidates. Let's set aside the fact that this is fiscally impossible. Is there a peril in signing a board with Bernie Sanders and a single-payer bill?
Well, it definitely, you know, puts you in the corner. I think later on, if you're elected, ultimately you would presumably have to pursue that kind of thing, which is, at least in the current climate, pretty unrealistic. I guess by the time there's a Democratic president, and who knows when that could happen, but there could be a Democratic House and Senate, and now we're totally into hypothetical land, but you'd need all of those things in order for this to happen. And even when they had all those things under Barack Obama, they couldn't make it happen. They couldn't get a public option included. So, yeah, I think there's a political peril here in promising something that you ultimately can't deliver, for sure.
You know, so it's so interesting to me that Bernie Sanders, an op-ed in the New York Times this morning, why we need Medicare for all, Hillary Clinton on a book tour. I mean, we're still talking about the Democrats who were the stars in the last presidential election. Who's up and coming? Yeah. I mean, where's the energy in the Democratic Party here if we're still talking about the past?
Well, one thing I do think that's interesting with all these prospective candidates signing on to the Bernie Sanders model of this, the suggestion is we're not going to have a moderate Democrat in the mold of Hillary Clinton represent the party come 2020, at least not one on health care, or not somebody we've heard of yet, simply because they're all signing on to the Medicare for All plan. So you can see the parties, you know, following the Trump mold of retreating to their corners, so to speak.
Meanwhile, some other Democrat senators met with President Trump last night, along with some Republican colleagues, to talk about tax reform. Those Democrats include Heidi Heitkamp, Joe Manchin, Joe Donnelly, those vulnerable Democrat senators in 2018. Is there, Zach, bipartisan agreement on tax reform, and what are those principles?
We don't know what the tax reform plan is yet,
right?
from the White House. They're still working that out. They need to come up with it pretty quickly. It's starting to sound a little bit like healthcare. If you kind of read between the lines, there are, you know, behind the scene negotiations going on only with Republicans, so far as we know. I think President is meeting with another bipartisan group today. So there is some bipartisanship there, but there's an asterisk you need to put next to all three of those names that you mentioned. They're all from states that Trump won, so they don't kind of represent the bulk of the party. And as long as Republicans are trying to pass tax reform with a 50 vote majority or 50 votes in the Senate, which is what they're trying to do, I don't think you can really call it a bipartisan effort.
I would say there's agreement that there should be tax cuts for companies and tax cuts for people. There's absolutely no agreement on what kind of tax goodies you cut to pay for that. And that's where the fighting is among the GOP.
Ted Cruz will also talk taxes at the Tax Foundation. Might have to answer some questions about some other issues as well, but we won't delve into that. We will discuss, though, what Sarah Sanders yesterday said from the White House podium. Eyebrow-raising comments. Let's listen.
Comey, by his own self-admission, leaked privileged information weeks before President Trump fired him. His actions were improper and likely could have been illegal.
Would the president encourage the DOJ to prosecute Comey?
That's not the president's role. That's the job of the Department of Justice, and something they should certainly look at.
Is that something you'd like to see?
I'm not sure about that specifically, but I think if there's ever a moment where we feel someone's broken the law, particularly if they're the head of the FBI, I think that's something that certainly should be looked at.
What do you make of that, that the Department of Justice should look at prosecuting former FBI Director James Comey?
I don't see that happening unless we learn something else about what Comey did. You know, nobody's really suggested he did anything illegal. And if you listen carefully to her words right there, Sarah Sanders doesn't really either. And in fact, the only people under active investigation are, you know, people at the White House as part of the Robert Mueller investigation. So this could be, a way to divert attention from all of that. But I'm not holding my breath for a Comey prosecution.
All right, Zach Wolf, thank you so much. Nice to see you this morning, bright and early from D.C.
All right, quick programming note. Hillary Clinton will speak tonight on CNN with Anderson Cooper. There's also a special Friday night with my man Will Ripley, Secret State Inside North Korea. So a lot happening tonight. Hillary Clinton on Anderson, Friday night, Will Ripley special on North Korea.
All right, will the newest sanctions against North Korea do anything to slow its nuclear ambitions? The president does not seem convinced. CNN is the only Western TV network broadcasting from Pyongyang. More from Will in North Korea next.
I don't know if it has any impact, but certainly it was nice to get a 15-0 vote. But those sanctions are nothing compared to what ultimately will have to happen.
President Trump offering his take on the new UN sanctions against North Korea, clearly not convinced they'll do any good. The president calling the measures, quote, not a big deal.
Now, North Korea's state-run agency calling the sanctions a heinous provocation by the U.S. CNN's Will Ripley, the only Western TV journalist reporting from North Korea. He joins us live from Pyongyang. Will, interesting to hear the president kind of throw cold water on what otherwise were thought to be some big sanctions.
Right. You heard the U.S. ambassador to the U.N., Nikki Haley, talking about what a strong, unprecedented sanctions package this was. But then you have President Trump basically acknowledging that the version that was approved unanimously was watered down to appease China and Russia, who didn't go along with the full oil embargo or blacklisting Kim Jong-un or grounding North Korea's only airline. Instead, what they're doing is capping oil exports by 30%, which could spike gas and energy prices here in the country. And there is an angry, a furious response from the North Korean government. The official response now, reiterating what officials told us here on the ground yesterday, that they condemn these sanctions in the strongest possible terms. They're calling it an economic blockade. They say the U.S. will pay for this, and they also say that they will redouble their efforts to develop their weapons programs even faster than before, their nuclear program and their missile program, which is the reason why they keep getting sanctioned, because these launches and nuclear tests are in violation of international law. In response, South Korea conducting a live fire drill of their own, testing for the first time a long-range air-to-surface missile that could potentially strike targets here inside North Korea. It's a direct threat to a country that has a growing nuclear arsenal, South Korea and the U.S., trying to find countermeasures, but tensions continue to escalate here, Dave.
All right, Will Ripley live for us in Pyongyang. Looking forward to your special Friday night. Thanks.
Thanks, Will. Let's get a check on CNN MoneyStream this morning. Global stocks are mixed after a record day on Wall Street. For the first time since July, all the three big major averages hit record highs, continuing a huge rally from the day before. There was also talk of tax reform. That helped. Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin says he is hopeful reform will happen this year, adding the administration may make tax cuts retroactive to January 1st. Apple introducing a trio of new iPhones, including a premium version worth a cool grand. 10 years after the launch of the first iPhone, Apple debuted the iPhone X. It has an edge-to-edge screen, scans your face to log in if customers don't want to spend a grand. Apple also unveiled the iPhone 8 and 8 Plus. Big news for the middle class. Middle class Americans got a pay raise in 2016.
Well, the story here in Florida is one of millions without power, and that extends beyond the state into Georgia, Alabama, and the Carolinas. In the Caribbean, devastation, and in some cases, there's desperation. We're in Bradenton, Florida tonight. The street I'm on doesn't have power, but most of the houses are intact. Obviously, the one behind me is not. A giant tree was blown over, and the roots, it lit up basically this entire side of the house, most of the house now. In the Florida Keys, there's a whole different scope, certainly, for what we're getting different estimates of the damage. I want to go to our Bill Weir on a boat in the Keys, which he's been riding around on since early this morning. You've been taking a look at the situation in the Keys today. I'm just wondering, what kind of damage are you seeing? You know, FEMA put out this figure, about 90% of the structures have some form of damage. I talked to an official from Key West who said he thought that was that was too high an estimate. I'm wondering what you've seen.
Well, you know, it's, I don't know about 90% of what we see. It's so interesting because the structures that are along the Atlantic Ocean, which took the brunt of the force, or those on the inside that took the dirty edge, are fortified. Some of the steepest damage is inside these keys where the houses aren't as structurally strong. I'll show you some video. I think we have it here of this is Marathon Key, and we went ashore. I saw this building that had looked like a laundry hanging from the railings and thought, boy, there's a sign of life, and went there. And it is so stunning to see what the waves of Irma did with all of the sand. Now, some keys don't have beaches, but in this one did. And it blew this sand up into the lobby of this condominium, in through the parking garage, into the up against the door where the sand was at least 3 feet high. And it was so surreal, which then lowered the ceiling. So he had to bend down to get around. And it was halfway up the elevator. and found one guy there who is the lone holdover, the caretaker of this condominium complex, a guy named William Dub Richardson. And I said, why didn't you leave? He said, well, I'm the caretaker. This is my job. And he hung out there and wrote it out, and he thought that this really fortified structure would come down it a couple times, but it didn't. And he survived. He says everybody that around him that he know has stayed has survived. And the first thing he did afterwards was hang this tattered American flag from those railings as a symbol that they made it through and they would rebuild. Anton.
Yeah. It's just amazing. Bill Weir, I appreciate that. I want to go now to Brian Todd in Isla Mirada. Brian, I'm wondering what you've been seeing today.
Well, Anderson, this is part of Isla Mirada. It's the southern part of it and you can see the devastation behind me. This is the Sandy Cove condominium complex here. Look at what happened to this. We'll have our photojournalist David Brooks kind of go in on some of this. This, what you're looking at here, is the third floor of this condominium complex. The first two floors, including the garage, were completely buried. This is the third floor. This is a 12-unit condominium complex that just got completely crushed, and the rest of it just got taken down, and the condominium got taken down in the storm surge. Not sure exactly how this happened, but we're on the southern tip of Isla Mirada here, and we talked to one of the owners of one of these units. His name is Tom Ross, 73 years old. He's had this place for 18 years. And his unit is that third, is that middle one right there, and again on the third floor. And he said that he believes everybody got out of here and evacuated, and it's a good thing, because if they hadn't, they wouldn't have survived this. You know, we saw him earlier today. He had the same look on his face that so many people have that we've come across just kind of keys here. When we first saw him, he just looked kind of shell-shocked. He was just standing there looking at this. He walked around to the back, and we talked to him back there. And he was, you know, he was rational, he was fine, but I asked him, I said, do you have any desire to come back here? And he said, oh, yeah, we're going to rebuild this place. I said, are you kidding? I mean, look at this. He said, look, this place was built in the 70s. And he says he knows it wasn't built to code back then, but after Hurricane Andrew in 1992, he believes that when they rebuild this, they're going to build it to code. It's going to be much stronger. And I said, yeah, but still, Tom, I mean, you know, it is susceptible to hurricanes on both sides, because the Atlantic coast is right here in front of us. And the bay is right basically at his back door. And he said, that's the reason I want to come back here. He said, where else can you look out your front door and you can see the Atlantic Ocean, and then you've got your boat tethered to the back there in the bay? Nowhere else. I've got to come back here. But his wife, Susan, he says,